Gracious God, we give you thanks for this very warm summer day. We give you thanks for the change of seasons, and suddenly it goes from spring to summer, and we're just, again, awestruck by your creation and how you change things, and sometimes we miss them, sometimes we don't. But Lord, we just give you thanks for this congregation, for Jim and Mira, who lead us so well, and we're just grateful people that you've given us the opportunity to kingdom build in Carlisle for you. We hope to do it honor to you, and we hope that you will lead us and continue to lead us as you have so far. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm going to begin with some congratulatory news to you. I got this email this week, and unbeknownst to all of us, as part of our connection to CUMC, we're now part of the Farm Service Agency. Who knew, right? Who knew? As a result of buying the Spring Garden campus and we lease it to a tenant farmer, we're now in the Cumberland County farmer and rancher community. So just an added benefit of membership at CUMC. But I just had to laugh, and I will forewarn you, when that email came into my laptop, I spent the rest of the day humming the Green Acres theme song. Now I'll challenge you to lose that out of your head today. Good luck with that. The next thing I want to mention is we're going to finally get a new projector in this room. So I know it's tough to see and everybody's squinting. It's a little better today with the darkness. But anyway, we're ordering one, going to replace the one in the back that's actually about 15 years old. So we've certainly got good service out of it. But this one's going to be mounted right over my head and suspended a little bit from the ceiling, shoot right on there. That will solve our problems, and the big thing is we're buying it so that we can take it with us, of course, and we use it in the new building. So just as you're squinting at these today, think positive that hopefully by next month you won't have to. Update on our capital campaign. You may have seen this on our midweek minute and so forth, but that is the total now, $3,047,338.71. Don't forget the 71 cents. But anyway, it's a fantastic number. We already have almost 510,000 has come in already. So again, thanks so much to everybody for that. It is just an incredible gesture of stewardship. Give yourself a hand, because that is fabulous. So that's our update as to where we are on that. Okay, one of the things we had talked about doing for this particular session was just where are we on what we're calling our master plan. And at this point in time, you've really already seen this. This is what we showed you last month. This is what's posted on the wall in the hallway and so forth. We haven't changed it at this point. So that particular footprint, the parking layout, all those things, we're considering that, okay, we're good as far as our site plan is concerned. That's kind of our master plan. Doesn't mean it won't get tweaked and changed, little bits here and there along the way, but the key is saying it's done enough to say we feel pretty good with it, is that now we can get our civil engineer going on what's called land development. And that's the whole process of really doing the design, designing the road, designing all the stormwater, and beginning through the permitting process, which can take about a year. So it's important for us to be at that point now to say, cut him loose and say, okay, get going. And, you know, if things change a little bit, we'll keep you posted, but we just want you to know that as far as we're concerned, we're in good enough shape to go with it. Whether we can afford to build the whole thing remains to be seen, as you know, but that doesn't mean even if we phase it, we still show the township the full design and get it approved. And then if we phase it, that's up to us. But we don't want to go in with a part of it and then have to go back later. So just an FYI on that. Same thing with this floor plan. This is what we showed you last time. It's about 69,000 square feet total. Again, from a master plan point of view, from saying, okay, that's the basics. That's how we think. That doesn't mean the inside won't change. We can shift things around. The lines that look like they're breaking the room, they don't have to be there. We can tweak and move and all that. The regulators don't care about that stuff. What they care about is the perimeter footprint and that we move on with that. So again, from overall master planning, this is what we're going with at this point. And as we get into the detailed design, which is really broken up into those different colored areas. I'll talk about that in a minute. But that's where we'll get into more of the guts of it and kind of really start to do the details. Budget-wise, here's an update. It's pretty close to what we showed you before, but the total available right now is just under $5 million. We have a line item for selling this facility, which we expect to get $1.5 million for. Our campaign one pledges, which I just updated right there. And then one of the key things I want you to remember in this budget, which comes out to about $12.8 million, includes an estimate on our second campaign. So we can't lose sight of that fact. We are estimating what the second three-year campaign will bring in, and that is a part of that budget. So that is the way we're looking at it, that if we want to try to do this project with no debt and build it within our means specifically, that $12.8 million is what we're looking at. And to put that into a little bit more context, again, I showed you this last time, and I've updated it. As a result of a few more gifts to the campaign and so forth, I've used $12.8 million here. It was $12.7 million. And the way we try to show you this is we're still at a point as we budget the building on a per square foot dollar amount. We're not in enough detail yet where our contractor could really give us more than that. However, he has given us a first shot based on that master plan. He has given us some ideas, and it actually falls right in this medium to high range where he's at. The low of about 140 square feet, and again, this is to build the whole thing when you look at these numbers. In order to do that, we're probably, it's not that it couldn't be done, but the way we're directing the architect and what we're kind of looking at, we're not there. It's a bit on the low side. The medium to the high, his actual numbers, what he gave us this past Tuesday, was $143 to $163 a square foot. So well within these ranges. I'm $140 to $175. So we're right in the right ranges. But we're just beginning to kind of get that data ahead. And he's going to go so far as to take the different areas of the building and say, this is what this piece costs, and this is what that. So as we move along here before our vote in September, we'll be able to say, here's what the different pieces are, and if we have to phase it, here's how much we think we can save by, you know, cutting back here or cutting back there. So I'm just trying to keep you up to date on where we are in budget right now. It's a moving target. But if we were to do the whole thing right now, remember this budget includes a second capital campaign. But if we were going to build the whole building, what our numbers are telling us right now is that we're somewhere $1 to $3 million short to build the entire thing. Now, if you put that in the context of these kind of numbers, 14 to 16 million, 1 to 3 doesn't sound so bad. But obviously, it's big dollars, and it's something we all have to get our heads around. It will be part of our vote as we move forward. Okay, so I'm just trying to, again, keep you, as we have these meetings, keep you in the loop of kind of where we are as a committee working with our architect and our contractor. Heading towards, I wanted to get these dates in early. We have two more of these sessions, July 16th and August 20th, if you can see that. We'll be just like this. We'll do it here in the sanctuary, then again in the MPR. Just again, progress meetings, keeping you up to date on what's going on. We schedule our vote. We have two votes, and that's required by our discipline. And the first vote is September 24th. So on September 17th, we put right here, we're going to have a combined worship service here in the sanctuary. Instead of three services, we'll have one, 9:15 to 10:15, and then take a short break and go immediately into about an hour and a half detailed information session with the idea of giving you all the information we're going to be able to provide to you a week prior to the vote. We plan to have our architect here, we plan to have our contractor here so they can help answer questions. So just to get some dates on your calendar, September 17th will be our first vote, and I'm going to show you in a second what we're going to be voting on. As it says here, I try to do sort of a when, who, what, how kind of thing. So our preliminary vote is September 24th. Our final vote is January 28th. We we've scheduled that too, just so people can begin to put these dates on your calendar. A week before the 28th, January 21st, we'll do the same thing. We'll have our architect and contractor here, have a combined worship service, and then give you all the information we can give you. You have a week to think about it and digest it. We'll have handouts and so on before the vote, okay? Who can vote? This is similar to the ones we've had when we voted Tina, fine, everything else. Per the discipline, you have to be a member of CUMC to vote. If you're not a member and you're involved and you're interested in this, you want to have a say in it, there are, I'm sure, new membership classes coming up, and you're more than welcome to join them. Just call the church office and you can get dates. But you do have to be a member to vote, so just keep that in mind. It'll be a written ballot, and once again, unfortunately, by the way our discipline works, you must be present. No absentee balloting. We've fought that battle many a time, but every time we bring it up, we lose. This is the Methodist system, and you must physically be here to vote. And we'll just vote in the worship services that day. It'll be a written ballot during the services. So what will be included for the preliminary vote? Again, this comes right out of our United Methodist discipline. We'll be voting on the preliminary architectural plans, the preliminary cost estimates, preliminary financial plan, and the building committee's recommendation. I had kind of forgot that was in the discipline, but it is. So they kind of force this group to stand up and tell you this is what we think, this is what we recommend. And then the big piece, I think, for us where we're headed in all this is right here. I believe that vote at the end of the day is going to say, do you want to do a phased building and try to keep this debt-free? Or do you want to do the full build-out and take on some debt? Now, at the beginning of all this, we said we're going to live within our means and do it. But I've heard, and our group has heard enough feedback from people saying, oh, wait a minute, maybe we should do the whole thing. Maybe this is a now or never. It's something every one of us in this room, all the members, have to really think about. How, you know, what's reality? That's where the financial plan will come in. When we show you that, we'll show you both ways of how we could maybe do it or not. But I'm just as a heads up, that is coming as part of the preliminary vote. And then the final, you're just, you know, everything's kind of repeated. It's just the final version. So let's say, for example, in September, the vote is, we want you to phase it. Then we focus on the final construction plans, or just that amount of the building that we're going to build. And we do all the details for that. The heavy amount of the design, for those of you on building teams that haven't met yet, which is most of you, because again, we just haven't been there yet, we're finally at that point where we can begin that between now and September. But the point I really want you to hear is the heavy, heavy design happens between here and here. That's when we'll really be doing the detailed design, and the building teams will be heavily involved. So there will be some involvement up front, but just, I know there's a lot of frustration, a lot of anxiety. You know, wait a minute, I signed up, I thought I'd have some say. We understand, it's just, you gotta understand the process we're working through with our architect. So it does take time to get to these points. The good news is we're finally at that time, which I'll talk about here in a second. So that's why I put up here, there'll be partial input for the building teams in the preliminary plans, and then there'll be full input for the final design. Okay? On the building team, which I'll get to in a second, land development I just talked about. That piece of it, is one of the building teams we have met. We're going to be again in July, for those of you who are on it, with our civil engineer, now that we can cut him loose. A traffic study has begun. If you drive by out there, you'll see those things across the road that count traffic and so on. One of our neighbors on the corner, as you turn into East Baltimore Street, the first house on the left, I've been getting a barrage of emails. What's going on? What's going on? What are you doing? I don't know. She signed up for a blog, and she's very anxious as to what's happening with our church. So people are paying attention to that, but that's underway. The other thing we've learned so far is what's called a tap fee. We have some idea. We knew these were coming, but for the privilege of tapping into the borough's sewer and water system, of course, we'll pay for our water and sewer along the way, but the first thing you do is pay a lump sum fee for the privilege to tap in. That's about $40,000 is what it looks like it's going to be. Unfortunately, those rates keep going up, and it's not cheap, but it's part of the process. So those fees are an ongoing thing we're beginning to get our head around as we go. We did budget for them, by the way. All right, building teams. You've seen this before, and everybody's here. This group up here chairs those teams. You will be hearing from your, if you've signed up or you're interested still in getting on one of these, you'll be hearing from that chair. Everybody listening? You'll be hearing from these chairs for a meeting either late June or early July. Some of it will still be preliminary. For example, amenities and decorating. We're kind of on the early side for that. But that doesn't mean you couldn't begin to look at that big welcoming connection area and at least start to think about it, what kind of furnishings and all that. So some of it will be preliminary, but we do want to get this moving. And what we've asked our architect to do is those colored pieces of the building for the different areas, he's blowing those up for us to make full-size drawings that then we can have on the table. You can sit around the table in your building and actually start marking them up with different things and different ideas and so on. So we're finally to that point, and we'll get going with the building teams. We have a couple of updates from a couple of the teams that have met, and Joanne and Courtney, if you would.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Joanne Reynolds, and although Jeff did point out that amenities and decoration, that's on down the road, I have the wonderful privilege of having two of these subcommittees. So if you read all the way down to the bottom, I'm also working with Worship and Music. Worship and Music has met, and the good news is that we did learn this week, as Jeff mentioned, we learned that it is time. That's what we learned. It is time. What it is now time to do is to begin to look at the interior spaces. We're not talking colors and floors and all of that. We're talking what happens in those spaces. What do we need in those spaces in order to make things happen? So for Worship and Music, we will have a subcommittee meeting on the 27th of June, and then we will meet with the architects in July to give them some more information on what the sacred spaces will look like in our new church. And then the second thing I wanted to mention is that along with Worship and Music, are you able to hear me? I'm getting some feedback. I'm not sure what signals I'm getting. It's okay. The second thing that we have begun to look at is specifically music. And what we have learned and been asked to do is to look at all of the merits of any kind of music that we have in our new sanctuary, especially the organ. There will be an organ, but we now understand that we have options, and we have options of pipe organ versus digital organ, not the old electronic organs that you and I have heard in smaller churches, but new concepts. And so this is just the beginning stages of gathering information on everything available out there. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Courtney Swarbley, and I chair the Youth Subcommittee. And we got a jump start at meeting. I started the Youth Subcommittee early because I'm expecting, and I didn't want to... when it was going to happen. Thank you, Jeff. And also given the summer schedule with our youth and with going on mission trips, we needed to get dates in the books. So we're a little bit ahead, which I'm very happy to report. So we've actually had already two meetings. We're having our third this Tuesday. Our first meeting was to go through logistics of what we anticipate the summer to be, what types of things that we need to consider. Just wanted to make sure. When considering a youth space, first and foremost, we have to consider the security of the space and, you know, what's around our space. We also have to consider, what does the flow look like? What does it, what makes sense for our space in terms of, you know, different areas of our space from the youth room to the game room to the gymnasium to the outdoors that we'll be utilizing, and how easily accessible is that for the kids, what their entrance looks like from a security standpoint, from a ease of use in terms of just being very clear to the youth, like this is where you enter, and making it simple for them. Obviously also considering the functionalities of the space, so what's going into the space, how much space do we need, what does it look like. Just already we've decided that it's going to be a space that's two stories in height, not necessarily two stories, two separate stories, but just so that it's a large area, and it appears to be a large area. Our second meeting, we actually toured two local church youth areas. We toured the Meeting House here in Carlisle, and we also toured the West Shore E Free Church, which is a very large, a large church in the back of Mechanicsburg. We got to see their youth spaces. We got to talk to their youth leader, to talk to them about what would you do differently, what do you like, and how do you use your space, because obviously not every youth program is the same and everybody uses them differently. At our third meeting, which is coming up, we're going to discuss with everybody in the group and the subcommittee what they liked, what they didn't like about these church tours, how we're thinking about laying out the space, how we're going to use the space. What does the kitchenette look like? What would you like in it? Just so we can have a better idea of the layout, because we are anticipating at the July meeting to have the architects there and get some more direction from the architects and be able to convey to the architects how, you know, what our vision is for what our needs are and how we use the space. So that's where we're at with the youth subcommittee. One thing that I just wanted to say in the beginning, our subcommittee is comprised of nine members. They include youth group leaders, members of our youth. So we have two members of our youth, and some parents, and some parents-to-be of future youth within the church as well. So I please, if you have your own thoughts about the youth space, don't hesitate to reach out to any of the subcommittee members or myself, or you have any questions, please don't hesitate. We're always looking for your input as well.
Thank you. I wanted to give you a couple other updates before we get to some visual stuff. The community campus, everybody's continues to ask. Some good news on that, we have reached a letter of intent agreement with the Smiths to purchase the balance of the farm. Remember, this is CUMC working together with the Carlisle Area Economic Development Corporation. They're really taking the lead on it. We're not putting any dollars into this whatsoever, but we're very integrally involved with the recruiting and the design and so on. So anyway, we finally reached an agreement, and we're able to now set a price per acre for the users who might be interested in it that we've been talking about. That price is $150,000 an acre is what we're... And that includes, of course, not only the land itself, but we're putting in the road network, all the extending the utilities, doing regional stormwater basins, getting it all rezoned for them. Basically, if one of these entities wants to buy one of those lots, they can walk in and go to work. Everything will have been pre-done for their use, with the exception of grading their site and doing any construction. So that is underway. We have our first commitment. Now that we've gotten the price and we're able to get that back to the interested party, our emergency shelter transitional housing is in the process of writing this letter right now. They are committed and ready to go. We have two others that we think are very close to that point, that being the Christian school and our life care community. That's why I put blue stars on those. We think they're close. They're at the board level now of getting board approval. So things continue to move forward on this faster than ever have imagined, and in a very positive way. We've also, how word spreads on things like this is beyond me, because we've done zero advertising, marketing, anything. But a local educational entity has made contact with some interest, higher level of education, has some interest, and also, of all things, a solar farm developer. touched base and said, kind of an interesting concept, just sort of see where this could or maybe would go. They're looking for maybe 15 acres, they're looking for a pretty big chunk of land. But the idea would be if they put that solar farm out there, they would give everybody on the campus, including the church, free electricity forever. So that could be pretty cool if something like that happens. They would build it, they would buy it, eventually be like a lease thing for 30 years or something. And the agreement would be they'd give everybody on the campus would get electricity, anything over and above that the solar field generates, they would sell to the grid. So the key to those kind of arrangements, if you kept up in the paper, I think the one the school district did, Carlisle, hasn't gone so well. Peter Rumley's, and I think it's the way the agreement was negotiated. The developer's going to try to put the risk on us, and you want it the absolute reverse. You want them to take the risk. That, you know, we get the power. Whether or not your field generates anything for you, that's your problem as a developer. So anyway, it's one to be very cautious about, but it's intriguing. So we'll see where that goes to. On the existing facility, where we're sitting right now, the latest on that, as it continues to change different ways, the latest repurposing use that I'm hearing, and this one's looking more and more like what it's going to be, is a mixed-use office and residential. The last time I stood up here and talked about it was a boutique hotel with a restaurant. So it's kind of changed a bit, but I believe this one's looking more and more real. I believe they're very close to an agreement with the developer for this idea of mixed-use office and condominiums or something like that. So I think they're pretty close to that, and we definitely anticipate a sales agreement with the church and Cumberland Area Economic Development Corporation sometime this summer. So that's getting closer and closer. The thing that keeps changing is the use. But we'll keep you posted as we keep learning more. Okay, the last part of our presentation is really where we are as a building committee right now. Now that we have a pretty good idea of our site plan, pretty good idea of our floor plan, now they're taking us down the path of, okay, what kind of look do you want to see in this building? And the first thing they did is kind of laid out a bunch of different options, different building. They weren't all churches, they were elementary schools, different examples of buildings. But they wanted to get some feedback from us of what kind of finishes do you like, what kind of materials, what kind of textures, what kind of colors, all that kind of thing. So Brad is going to walk you through a little bit of what we heard or what we looked at and kind of why. And then after that, we will show you a first shot at some possible sketches.
Good morning, Brad Weiser. I can't walk and chew gum at the same time. I'm not sure that I can handle the mic, the laser pointer, and my notes, so bear with me if it turns into a snowfall. As Jeff said, we looked at a ton of different institutional-type buildings, not all churches, just to get an idea of material use, and really, I think what the architects were looking for was what generated conversation, what created that sort of visceral response in different elements, just to both good and bad. And I'm going to try and steer away from the pro and con and really just say what elements were the conversation starters and which ones sort of started to drive on the exterior a little bit. Before we get going, the main thing I want to probably point out is we're showing these not as a finished product, but to kind of give you a glimpse to the process. So as we go through, don't get too emotionally connected to any of them, because these are, like I said, there's a lot of, we do like this, we don't like this, but that's all just seeking out so that we can sort of narrow down. On our first example here, some of the things we were looking at were, there's some trellises right here on the outdoor space. That generated a little bit of conversation. The angular roof lines here, and then also the high light sources with these windows coming in a second story. Definitely a church, but there are also some different components where, the high light coming in here, But then this sort of retail reveal that's on the front, and again, newer projector, better image, I'm sure that we can come back around to these. But the other part was mixed use. There's some masonry here, but metal roofing of materials up here. Some of that is what is appealing. Part of it is also for the contractor to figure out what appeals to us, and so he can say, get out your wallets, or we can afford that. A couple of things here. We have a very, very visible cross element. Visible from all directions. It doesn't show up on the face. For our particular site, that has a certain amount of appeal because we do have a lot of different lines of visibility coming in. We're also taking a look just at drop-off spaces here as we went through some of these examples. And again, the mixed material use. It's a little difficult to see, but there's a stone veneer that's on the lower portion of this that gives kind of a nice accent, but then some less expensive material that was built into the top side. This again was looking at entryway. Our portico area here, as far as covered access to get into the building. Also, just the design element as one of the main things that you see with these angled roof lines and the staggered the sort of staggered lines as you approach from an appeal standpoint. And then again, this sort of outdoor space as an outdoor gathering area. We have, The other piece here is, again, the mixed material with this sort of stone veneer accent mixed in with some lesser expensive stucco or drywall. This is a pretty striking example. Some of the elements here, again, we have, it's not the trellising, but there's an open outdoor roof space that really gives kind of a very modern feel. A little bit of an industrial feel, but then we come back to a little bit more traditional with our center-mounted cross, and obviously one of the big things here was just the sheer amount of natural light that these types of window structures or window layouts would bring in. Up here, even on this, kind of in that second or story and a half area, again, bringing in a lot of natural light in up top. Some of the focus here was, again, on just the mixed material use as far as what is cost-effective and what isn't, but it's a little bit difficult to see. The other thing that was kind of pointed out here was how we change texture on the vertical. So there is, these are little bump outs here. We recess back underneath for the porch area. There's a vertical difference along this line where it's metal and then it's brick down below. Kind of see it over here as well, just to give a little bit of texture so it's not just a square building. And then talking about, I forget exactly what kind of panels these were, but as a finish element on the outside versus siding or anything like that. We did again, we see some angular roof lines here, but I believe this was sort of semi-circle curve as it goes around. It was just part of the discussion, you know, do we like sharp lines, do we like softer lines? Here, one of these, and it's sort of an imagery manipulation technique. When we slow down the backlighting and get kind of a night scene, it gives us the effect of what this reveal of these two-story lights are going to look like in the evenings when anybody is approaching the building. There were a couple of other examples further back that had those real high windows. They didn't show up as much because they were in the sunlight there, but they kind of wanted to show what this, you know, we're morning, noon, and night kind of facility, so what's that going to look like, what's going to stand out to people as we, as they come to our building at different times. Again, with just the curved drop-off point to get us up as close to the door and the entryway as possible, we really want to shorten that distance. And again, mixed materials. This was kind of an aluminum accent piece here, but then again, we're back to masonry on the outside. Just the mix of materials was something that seemed to stand out as something that was kind of appealing to everyone, is so that we could touch on a lot of different taste elements. Here again, lots of highlight coming in. Those panels kind of creating that texture off to the side here, and angular roof lines that help create this extra light space, but also, depending on which way you're coming in, the building's going to take on a little different feeling based on what your point of view or your angle coming in is going to be. Again, this outdoor gathering space, you know, when the weather is good, do we want that to be open, similar to this? Do we want to create a little bit more cover so that potentially in real sunny conditions or maybe light overcast conditions, we can still spend some gathering time there? This one was just another emphasis of a lot of that natural light coming in, but sort of some more industrial type materials with some of this reclaimed wood fascia that was going on here, and the inside being open metal trusses without sort of a finished solid roof. It's a much more modern or urban feel that came in here, even with just normal can lights, sort of like what we have up in the MPR. This was one that was kind of incorporated with some other buildings going on around it, but they wanted to do accents with these materials. Again, just a metal siding that's on here, kind of that storefront retail reveal, but obviously with our signage, we certainly know that it's a church. A little bit more warmth that comes in with the wood. But this is just a real clean, simple logoing kind of design that we took a look at. Again, not all these were, we like this, we don't like it. It was just kind of some of the examples they showed us to see what got a response. This is a little bit different. Again, we looked at the materials, a lot of natural light that was coming in here. This outdoor space, again, we certainly want to try and incorporate that and figure out, you know, is covered use the best use? Is open use the best use? What stood out here was these low entry light levels. That's light that's coming in at floor level, and then essentially nothing else on the inside of there. Everything's got to come in from the front side. So it's just a kind of a unique way to bring natural light in, but retaining a lot of this wall space that we're not sure what they were doing inside, whether it's presentation screen or something like that. But it was just a different way to come about it.
Thank you, Brad.
Sounded like an architect.
Okay, so with that said, this our meeting on this past Tuesday night, they took some of those elements and gave us a couple of sketches to give us an idea. An idea. Notice the word in red up there? Everybody repeat after me.
Yeah.
Possible. Possible.
Possible.
Just keep remembering that. This isn't it, folks. This is nothing more than a first shot at taking some of those elements and applying them to our footprint. The other thing that cities do for the first time, they're, again, in architectural terms, now we're to the point where we've been in two dimensions, a floor plan. Now we bring in the third dimension. They call it volume. What's the volume of the building? Meaning like the height from here to there, times the width, times the length. So now we start to look at what the pieces we've directed them and asked them, we want this piece two stories, we want this piece one story, whatever. Now we get a sense of that from the footprint. And lastly, and Brad already touched on it and did it well, what Walden really emphasized to us is the purpose of this at this point is to get an idea of what, you've probably heard the term form versus function. That's kind of an architectural thing. This is the form piece. And it boils down to as simple as, do you like curves or do you like straight lines in your different components of the building, things like that. Okay? Possible. Everybody's going to leave this room thinking, well, we saw a possibility or two, right? Okay. Here's their first attempt at this. I'm sorry if I'm in anybody's way. the main elements to kind of look at. This is the worship center, which as you can see is a solid two stories in height. That's sort of the gathering connection space, also two stories in height. The gym is over here. This is the adult space. Youth and children are back here. A story and a half to two stories. That one doesn't really show it too well. And over in here is the administrative offices, the nursery, and little lights. So to just get you a flavor of it, I have one sort of a blow-up sketch of this. But the elements that they really try to point out to us here is they use curves. It's sort of a curved roof here. Around each window, as you can see, there's a little bit of a curve. So there's kind of a blow-up of the entrance area. And again, this is nothing more than trying to take our basic concept of a floor plan and now add some pieces to it to give us an idea of height and, again, form, curves, or straight lines. Even this under canopy for driving in a drop-off, curved roof. So that's where he's taking us right now. What kind of things like that? What do we like? Where are we on that? Here's the second one they showed us. This one is all straight lines. So here's the difference where, again, it's the same building footprint, little lights, adults and nursery, worship space, connection space, gym. Back of that is youth and children. In front of it's adults. And this one, again, as you can see, they actually call this a butterfly roof. It's a more striking, more bold kind of an approach to it. But the thing that Walden pointed out to us, they keep thinking about open arms, open eyes, open hearts, open minds of the Methodist tradition, this open arm. And that element of that roof line, they thought, helps represent that idea of coming together and a welcoming, everyone's welcome kind of approach. Same thing, this canopy roof, same shape of room, the gym, or roof, excuse me, roof, same kind of shape. This one's a lot more expensive. Those butterfly roofs are not cheap. Our contractor already gave us a heads up that this may be pushing it into budget. But again, that's really not where we're at this point, more so than the feel, the look. Look at the two stories, one story, all one story. So as you drive into the building, as you come in East Baltimore Street, come to the top where that cul-de-sac's going to be, and you look across the field, you're looking across the athletic fields and the parking lot and everything, your first impression of the building is going to be pretty much the lines of it is what you're going to see. And that's where he has us focused right now. A blow up on that, where it gives you a little bit better idea. Does it have to be this dramatic of a line? No, they can definitely soften that. He said we can combine straight lines and curves. We can do all kinds of things. But that's what he's looking at us to get some like feedback. What kind of thing do we like? Obviously, we're not into colors and textures and different materials. We're not there yet. This is just the beginnings of what maybe could have looked like. There's a book out there called Chasing the Line by Mark Batterson. It's pretty new. It's a New York Times bestseller. He's a Christian author. His subtitle is, If Your Dream Doesn't Scare You, It's Too Small. Your dream doesn't scare you, it's too small. You've just seen some of those images. And what I want you to do right now, everybody in the room, close your eyes. Close your eyes and listen to me read a couple excerpts from this book with those images kind of in your head of what you just saw. What are you doing today that will make a difference 100 years from now? Every generation must steward what's been entrusted to them. It starts with honoring the generation that has gone before us by learning everything we can from them. But that's only half the equation when it comes to passing along a generational blessing. It continues by empowering the generation that comes after us. That's how the baton of blessing is passed to the third and fourth generation. And that is what the psalmist advocated in Psalm 78. so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Your greatest legacy isn't your dream. Your greatest legacy is the next generation of dreamers that your dream inspires, the dream within a dream. And lastly, is your dream about you, or is it about others? If your dream is about you, no one will rally around it. If your dream is about others, you won't be able to keep people away. If your dream is about others, you won't be able to keep people away. You can open your eyes, but I just want you to be thinking that kind of an approach. That's how your building committee is thinking. We're trying hard to set the table for the next generations of CUMC that are coming. And with that said, for your comments, we'll absolutely love them. While we're going around with that, one other thing I want to say. We've been thinking about, as we, you know, this is the beginning of seeing some images. There's obviously going to be more in the months ahead. And we're trying to come up with how can we have a way to do this to allow all of you to truly get some feedback back to us. Obviously, this setting is tough. You saw each slide for, what, 30 seconds, 60 seconds? We had the benefit of a whole meeting with the contractors, so it's a whole different element. What I think we're going to try to do is put some online surveys up. There's a software that Mira is well familiar with and uses called SurveyMonkey, and we can subscribe to it and put some surveys up with some questions, and we can put images on it, and we can put in comment boxes on it. So we give everybody a chance in real time to sit down in front of your computer, look at this, study it like we're having the opportunity to do, and then comment. So I just want you to know we're really trying to actively think of how can we do this to give everybody a fair chance to have some input to these kind of things. It's tough, obviously, with a congregation this size, but you know, we crave your input. We really, truly do. And we want to have a way to be able to do that, and that's kind of where we're headed. We hope in the next few weeks we'll have some more.
And I applaud you for putting a lot of this stuff on the website. There's a source of information there. Up to this point, we've seen the footprint. We also know the overall square footage. You mentioned that the architect will now be giving blow-ups of the certain sections for the subcommittees to look at. Will those blow-ups include square footage so we can sort of compare it to what we currently have?
What it's going to be is, in the engineering architecture world, they use kind of a real strange scale. What we're going to do is I'm going to teach you all of the architects at the subcommittee level, where you can put a scale to a drawing and get the actual square feet. They're not to the point of actually calling out the dimensions, but it's really easy once I show you how to do it, that we can do that ourselves and begin to get dimensions to that. And they're going to set up the size of the drawing so that'll be pretty readily doable. Because yes, we're ready for that now. And we may find some of these rooms, whoops, that's too small, whoops, that's too big, and we'll just begin to direct them to shift the lines, and we can just scribble right on there. We want this office 8x10. You have a 12x12, we don't need that. You know, that kind of thing, Ken. So now we're finally getting to that point where we can begin to get into this a little bit more. Where do we want a closet? Are the restrooms right? Are they big enough? Are there enough stalls? All that kind of stuff. Now we're finally into that. Brett,
Dick Felty, someone asked me a question I couldn't answer. It's something I've thought about. Is the columbarium going to be part of this building?
Has it
been considered?
It has come up. You're right, but honestly, we haven't got there yet either, Dick, at this point.
That's fine. You don't have to have a final answer.
Yeah.
We have plenty of ground.
Yeah.
All space. I just want to add, with our 25 acres, there are plenty of possibilities for future building and future development. We are by no means using up our land. Mm-hmm. Keep the dream.
you hear me?
No.
Jay Birch, and you said about the different types of organs. When we left Allison, I believe that organ was put in storage. Is that not one of the considerations for an organ?
Absolutely, you are right, Jane. That organ remains in very good care. It has been climate controlled, all kinds of protection for it. That organ is in storage and is in excellent shape.
Is that being one of the ones that might be considered?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Sue Baxter, I just wanted to ask, and maybe it's already been answered, is there still only the one entrance into the church, the one street in, or are we able to have two entrances?
At this point, Sue, we're focused on that East Baltimore Street, and the main thing we're waiting on right now is the reality of that community campus, because if that does become reality, as it's looking more and more like it will, we can interconnect with that road network right off our parking lot, and that gives us two more access points out onto Southbrook Garden Street. So that really takes care of it in a large way. We haven't gone any further at this point with the borough or South Middleton about going through Seven Gables Park. We've just kind of sat on that for now. This traffic study thing's gotten a little dicey, and we've learned some pressure points of where the borough has concern about the traffic signal at the intersection of Pomfret, South Spring Garden, and the road that goes off the scales. I can't think of the name of that road, but that intersection, they're a little concerned about maybe the traffic light needs retimed or actually turned into an automatic traffic light to the tune of about $150,000. And guess who they'd be looking at to pay for that if it becomes an issue? On the other direction, going down South Spring Garden Street towards the quarry and beyond, there's a little tiny one-lane bridge down there. If you've ever driven, it's a beautiful drive, by the way. But when you get down there, as you come around the bend, there's a little one-lane bridge. South Middleton has that on the radar screen as something they're concerned about. So we have to play this kind of carefully, because a lot of the traffic study data is based on our seating capacity of the worship center and then weekday use. So I think we're going to be all right in the whole thing. But if we, in the early meetings, as we learned all this, adding in one more component, like let's talk about Seven Gables Part 2, I kind of thought enough already. This is dicey enough as it is. Let's just get approved and get there, and then we could bring that up another time if we so choose.
When you're asked to vote on the preliminary vote, I think, if it comes down to the full build out versus a partial, we have to prioritize. Would the priority go to the building, even if it means that will defer some of the unnecessary, the land development, you know, the optional land development, non-essential land development later?
I think probably where we're headed, Ken, is try to give some true options for that. You know, we could do it this way. We could, obviously, there's going to be a number of ways we could do it, right? Different pieces of the building, different this, cut back on some of the site development. At least what's in my head right now, and as a committee, we haven't really talked about it. But just to begin to think, we got to give some alternatives, you know, about how do we do it and that kind of thing. So,
because I would think the time to do the building stuff would be now, you know, when it's under construction. It's so much easier to do it then than down the road. Not to build out necessarily everything, but don't cut corners, so to speak, on something that you might need.
Right. That's where we go back to that master plan. That's where we want the whole thing in our heads. Here's what we would like to do, 69,000 square feet. If we can't afford it, if we choose to go a different route financially, then, okay, well, how much of it will we build and what's the priorities of those different pieces? One of the things we talked about already with the contract, and this is really the beauty of having him at the table with us through design, I can tell you that our whole committee is absolutely thrilled with, the man's name is Nathan Fry, he's the estimator for Arthur Baum and Sons, and he is, number one, a walking encyclopedia of the building code, and number two, a very solid Christian, and number three, just fabulous thinker and full of information. He's jumped ahead of, without us even asking, he's already looking at different scenarios and numbers and phrases. It's just terrific. But one of the things he did, kind of gives the heads up, and some of this is common sense and some of it maybe not, he said, and just remember, if we do end up phasing, there's a cost to phasing in the sense of you're going to add walls where you really don't want a wall, and then later you're going to tear it out. So you just spent money that you know full well, you're going to pull back. It just goes with the territory. I mean, that's just the way of life. But it is a reality, and it's those kind of numbers we want to look at, too. And the other piece of it is, of course, things as you wait don't get any less expensive. We all know things go up, labor costs, material costs, and all that. So it's just another factor. We'll be leaning very hard on our financial sub-building team, and a few of you are in the room right now, to really help develop some scenarios. Okay, what could this look like? What are our options with mortgages or banks or whatever? And just kind of get a sense of what makes that. Any questions or comments? If you raise your hand, and we have a mic for you, and if you can stick your name up too.
Noel Murtoff, have you thought anything about the loop hearing system in the new church? I came from, I spend my winters down in Florida, and our church down there put that loop hearing system in. And for those that has hearing impaired, it comes right into your hearing aids, and you also have other systems that, if you don't have a hearing aid, it works. But that's a very nice system.
Absolutely. No, we have a subcommittee, one of our building teams that is set up to do accessibility and needs and that kind of thing. We've heard of that technology, and the time to put it in is during construction. And absolutely, we're looking at that for the classrooms, as much as we can. We definitely intend to put that in. I don't have a name right now, but I just joined the club of hearing aids myself, so I didn't know where you're coming from.
Scratchy voice when you do this, but on Team Bar, I just wanted to commend the architectural firm. I think both the renderings were beautiful. I thought both the curves and the butterfly wings were just absolutely gorgeous, and either one of them would be great. And I think you're doing a fine job for us, and I just wanted to give you some feedback on it.
So. Well, thank you very much. There, the budding architect. Say, pass that on. Did we overwhelm you with information? I know it's a lot. It is a lot. And this is moving at a fast pace. We kind of said that at the beginning. We're moving right along here. And the good news is that we've had, at least amongst our team, you can clearly see a few of us are on vacation this week, but we're a diverse group, and that's on purpose. But I have truly been amazed to watch God work amongst us as a group and help us build consensus where we may not all come at it from the same background, same opinions, and same ages, and everything else. I'm the youngest in here, of course, but I allow my seniors to, help. But in any event, it really is cool. It's been a great experience, I think any of us would say. And it's we're blessed with a very Christian architect and a very Christian general contractor. Those quotes, that book, that came from the architect. After our meeting, he said, the three of them that were up here on Tuesday yacked away the whole drive back, and very passionately, and then two of them happened to be reading that book. So just felt compelled to send those quotes because they know where we are, trying to make these kind of decisions. And, they're just co-laboring with us, as they said. But it's a great experience. So if you can kind of sense that, but we're enjoying it, and I think the outcomes could be better. Anybody want to add anything?
Something else that came up Tuesday night is when we saw the drawings at first, we sort of went, whoa, this is different. This is maybe not what we were picturing. Parts of it are what we would picture. Parts of it may be strange. And so we had all kinds of reaction in the committee itself. And the architect sat there, and after quite a while, he said, I have a feeling you folks are trying to be safe, that you are maybe afraid to reach out there and try something new. So he challenged us to break away from feeling safe. And we all need to challenge ourselves to do that. This is an awesome group to work with, and we really, truly do encourage you all to get involved, at least in conversation with us. We all are probably at the point of carrying notepads and pens with us. Anytime that you have a thought, please do share it. I will also share a question, if I may, from the first session. Someone asked, do we plan a columbarium? If you're not familiar with that, it's similar to a wall where you have niches that you place ashes with some sort of a memorial tribute to a person. It takes place in the cemetery. And so our answer for now is no, we don't have a plan for that, but with 25 acres, that is certainly something that we can think about for future. So with as much land as we have, we certainly can continue to dream dreams. Thank you.
Last thing I want to kind of leave you with as you think about it is going back to that voting slide, you know, which way do we go? Something to begin to ponder. Do we set out to do this debt-free? That's still very much a possibility. Absolutely do that, but all appearances at this point is we can't afford the whole building, the whole site development. So how will we break it down and phase it? We intend to give you options and vote in September of some different ways we could do that and do it debt-free, so to speak. Or do we look at the alternative and what kind of financial arrangements could we come up with to possibly be able to carry some debt if that's the way that we choose to go. The key there being this group is not making that decision, not even close. We're going to set the table and give you the options, then everybody, all voting members, will make that decision. But a couple of things the contractor left us with, and some things are pretty obvious and some maybe not, he said just as you begin to think about phasing, and he's actually begun to think about it for us and threw out a couple of different ways we could scale back here or there, he said just remember, when you do that, you're going to be adding a wall to break off, let's say, a piece of the building that you don't want that long term. So you're going to build that wall and incur that expense, and then later on, you might come back and tear it all out. So he said, obviously, there's a cost to phasing. And at the same time, the other thing that we all know so well is that things don't get cheaper as time goes on. It gets more expensive for labor, for materials, all those kind of things. So there's another cost there. Just more things to keep in mind as we go through it. But our goal will be to give you all the information you need to make a decision. We're going to lean very heavily on our financial subcommittee to really dig into the options and just look this over for us and see which way we want to go. But again, the congregation needs to decide.